Live. Oh, it says we're streaming.
I love it.
Let's double check. I'll get it pulled up over here in case anyone comments.
I'm doing the same thing now.
Welcome, Justice. Thanks for being here. Same to you, Melissa. I said hi, but it was kind of a quiet day.
We are streaming.
Awesome. All right. Well, welcome everyone. We're into day 4, goodness gracious, of our March Wellness Week challenge. All this week we've been just going back to the basics. So we're covering the Epic 5 pillars. We talked about hydration, diet yesterday. Dan talked about movement. Today we're going to be talking about stress, but more specifically how your physical environment could be affecting your well-being, and just talking about, you know, talking along those lines. And Dan yesterday is going to dive into blue light. So all about, you know, sunshine, blue light, the different light, you know, options that we have to us, and also just limiting blue light exposure and how that may be affecting our sleep. So, but without further ado, we've got a special guest with us here, Dr. Jason Bradley. Welcome, welcome.
I just put on my blue blockers. It's
oh my goodness.
Totally, like, I didn't even know you were going to say that. I've been in front of a screen all day, and I was like, you know what?
Yeah.
I'm going to give my eyes a little bit of a break from this screen.
There you go.
Yeah, great. I mean, that wasn't even planned, you know? So
great minds think alike. See,
I'm telling
this
you
is why we work well together.
I know. I'm telling you, Tristan Swanwick, who these are Swannies, you know, I'll promote mm-hmm. them, but these are Swannies. Tristan Swanwick is a good friend of ours, and he would be very proud about this product placement, you know.
Coming together. I love it. And yeah, but like I said, Dan's going to be talking a lot more tomorrow about, yeah, just the different options. Like Dr. Bradley's got specific glasses that help reduce the blue light exposure for him. So yeah, if you want to learn more about that, there's a little, we'll dangle that carrot there for you. Chime in tomorrow at 1 o'clock standard time or Central Standard Time, and you can, you know, chat with Dan about it. So, but today again, I want to chat just really how much of an impact our physical environment specifically has on us. So within our physical environment, you know, there's a lot to consider there. And I'm actually going to kind of tackle it in pieces. So, well, actually, no, before we get into that, I want to just touch on a few points of, you know, how can our environment affect our health and that affect our health, and then we'll kind of build on those. So to start here, so our environment can facilitate or discourage, you know, interactions or actions, you know, among people within the home or among, you know, the changes you're trying to make. Your physical environment can, you know, it can hinder that, or it can, you know, help facilitate that. There's another word I'm looking for that's not coming to mind, but you get the gist there. And the environment also can, again, just influence someone's willingness or motivation to take action. And we'll kind of dive into more specifics on that in a second. And last but not least, again, these are just three basics. I know there's more that goes along with this too, but our environment can affect our mood and our stress levels and, you know, how we're feeling. So kind of diving into a couple of those, the second one specifically, how can our environment affect our motivation to act? That's a big question. I have a couple specific examples that come to mind. One of them is when considering, like, again, we're getting into spring. We're, you know, doing a little bit of spring cleaning, and that can mean a lot of things with, you know, decluttering, maybe our closets, maybe our cupboards. And that's one thing that we recommend to pretty much everyone as they initially come in here, specifically with decluttering the cupboards and, you know, the pantry. The more that, you know, it's really just setting yourself up for success. And I told Dr. Bradley right before this, there's a quote from Marie Kondo, who wrote, she had a book about, you know, the magic art of tidying up. She also had like a Netflix series. I don't know if it's still on Netflix, but definitely worth checking out if you haven't. But her quote is, "The question of what you want to own is actually the question of how you want to live your life," which I think is really cool and especially relevant within the dietary decluttering, if you will, because, Yeah, what we put into our body is going, that's what's going to fuel us, and that's what's going to give us our energy. And if, you know, if we want to live the life with, you know, optimum energy, we've kind of got to work into the optimum foods bit. Yeah, what's your thought, Dr. B?
Well, I was just going to say, it reminded me, you know, since we're having quotes, it reminded me of a really like a genius quote the other day. I'm just kidding, because it was by me. So you know that it's awesome. No, and I don't remember exactly what I said, but you know, it was some kind of post that said something like, you know, I've been doing this for a long time, and I can tell you that, you know, help is found in more in what you are willing to give up than what you're willing to take. And you know, because everyone wants to say things like, hey, you know, I've got fill in the blank, you know, whether it's fatigue, or I've got a thyroid problem, or I've got an autoimmunity, or I've got, you know, weight loss resistance, or I've got cardiometabolic syndrome and high blood pressure. And this, you know, I mean, whatever it is. And everybody wants to know, what can I take? You know, what can I take for energy? What can I take for high blood pressure? What can I take for my thyroid problem? And you and I have been doing this long enough that we know that almost always the solution lies more, at least as much in what we're willing to get rid of and purge, as opposed to what we're going to add in, you know. And it just reminds me of wherever that quote was in there, you know, but it reminded me of that space as well, that it's environmental, but it's just so much bigger than that. Once we get our heads around this idea of simplification, you know, really is what it comes down to. But sorry, I didn't mean to hijack. Go ahead.
Oh, no, you're good. I think, yeah, definitely just being clear with, I think that also kind of ties, you know, even tying deeper into like your values and what do you really want? Like what matters the most to you? And also, yeah, within like, you know, how you're feeling, how are these things that you're currently doing or including, how just being honest with yourself and, you know, being mindful of, you know, are these foods or is this thing that I'm doing negatively affecting my health in a way that, yeah, and I'd rather kind of flip the script.
Absolutely. And I was just going to say too, I think that a lot of times we all, I think, and now I don't want to make too broad of a generalization on this, but I think that most of us know this set of foods over here is healthy and this set of foods over here is not healthy, right? Let's just pretend that we are all on the same page there, right? Don't you hear from a lot of people, yes, but my family, right? Over here, I know for me, I need this, but my family really likes this stuff, right? Yep. So therefore I'm going to keep it in my pantry. I can't clean out my pantry, right? Yep. What do we do about that?
So to that, I would say, you know, I totally understand that, you know, a lot of the people coming into Epic and making these changes, their family isn't gonna, you know, hop on board right away. And some of them do. Some of them do love, you know, it's not too much of a switch, just kind of, you know, getting some more vegetables or whatever that may be. But I would say, you know, if that is the case where, you know, your family is going to be enjoying some things that you know don't make you feel good, there's a couple ways that you can kind of organize the cupboards in a way to sort of like out of sight, out of mind. So if, you know, if they could have a designated cupboard, or if they can, you know, if they're bringing cookies or snacks into it, have them take it into their room and put it somewhere where you're not going to see it and not going to, you know, it just, trying your best to limit that temptation, because it's a lot easier, you know, if it's out of sight, out of mind, but if it's in the cupboard every time you look at it, you know, it's going to get harder and harder to resist whatever that is. And so, you know, if we can organize it in a way that, cool, you know, this cupboard is specifically things that I, you know, don't eat or don't agree with me. And, you know, we can just keep that there. And all the other stuff is, yeah, stuff that I know is going to make me feel good. But that definitely is, you know, easier said than done. And it takes, you know, some practice. And I think too, I don't know, this is going a little bit farther. It's been fun for me too, though, to see as, you know, an individual within their family starts to make these changes and their family starts to notice like the changes of the positive changes in how they're feeling and their, you know, their energy, their willingness, motivation, ability to do more things. I love just seeing how the families kind of slowly start to take on, you know, those same actions. And they're like, okay, yeah, I'll have some more vegetables with you, or, you know, I'll do whatever. And, you know, it's a work in progress. And again, like, even from personal example, my father, bless his heart, me and my mom are very like pretty much like on Epic Five, maybe some other things occasionally, but my dad is like the typical meat, potatoes, like our vegetables growing up were corn, green beans, and peas, and sometimes some radishes and potatoes. But like, that's just what we were used to. And that's what we've grown up on. And so like, for that, me and my mom just have to realize like, well, I'm going to do what I know is going to make me feel the best. You can lead a horse to water, but you can't make them drink it. So that's kind of where we're at there. And it definitely can make things, you know, difficult at times, but you know, again, we know what works better for us to feel good. And yeah, it's kind of on him if he doesn't want to feel good too. So, but yeah, you had a thought, Dr. B.
Yeah, no, I was just going to say a couple of things. It can be a challenge, right? Mm-hmm. However, I was going to say, unless you're a jerk like I am, right? And what I mean by that is, you know, I know right now that in our fridge, in our freezer, in our dry goods, in our pantry, right? There's tons of food there. There's tons of food options, as a matter of fact. And if somebody's hungry in my house, I can feed them. I could have the neighborhood come over right now and I could feed the neighborhood, right? I know that. And it would be healthy. I mean, it would be healthy food. On that note, however, you know, our kids have a different opinion. They tell me all the time that there's no food in our house. Like, we never have any food. And I'm like, what are you talking about? Our food budget is only second to our mortgage payment. You know, I mean, I don't even know what you're talking about. You know, we have so much food. And then they say, well, nothing good to eat. And I'm like, what are you talking about? It's all good to eat. It's all good for you. And they're like,
Dad,
you know what I mean. And I'm like, no, I do know what you mean. But the reality is, for me, I take kind of a hard-nosed approach to it.
Yeah.
Where I just don't want it in the house. And if it creeps into the house, as an example, one of our older daughter's friends is turning however old this Friday, I think 20, probably 21. So I know. And we're hosting the party, right? I know. I can only imagine what it's going to be like, right? But I know that after that party, there will be remnants of that party because, you know, all the kids, they're at that age where they're going to bring some food over, you know, and it's not going to be on plan. And then they're going to leave and there's going to be remnants of the stuff. And I'll tell you right where it's going to go. It's going to go into file 13. Yeah, exactly. It's going to go directly in there. And I already told her, I said, I don't want that crap in my pantry. I said, I'm not judging, it's your party. It's your friends. Yeah. I totally get it. However, it will not stay in my house. It's going into the trash and literally going into the bin outside. I don't even want it in the house. And that's the way I manage my household. And I'll tell you why. It is because I'm a jerk, right? But the reality is I'll eat it, you know, even with the best willpower, even with, you know, this is my job. This is second to religion to me, right? I'm still going to not have the willpower to forego all of it. So I don't even want to see it. You know, I don't even want it. I don't even want it. So again, first and foremost, so these were two connected thoughts. First and foremost, give yourself permission to be a jerk if that's what it takes, you know, and you can label it something else, you know, be firm. Maybe that's a good way to say it tough love. Or the other thing I was going to say goes hand in hand with this is give yourself permission to prioritize you. Right? Because that's where we fail a lot. So many of us prioritize everyone and everything else before ourselves. You know, we will prioritize our children and our spouses and our work and our friends and our church groups and our this and our that. And then where are we left? We're left with, well, hopefully at the end of the day, we're left with scraps at best at the end of the day, if we're not too exhausted to move anyway, right? Mm-hmm. And the reality is, we deserve every single one of us to prioritize ourselves. But if you're not,
yes, we do.
And here's the tough thing. If you're not in that psychological space to be able to own that statement, and I get it, it took me a lot of years to get there because I have that social conditioning as well, right? But I'm there now. If you're not there, then go ahead and prioritize everyone else. That's fine. But realize they need you to be your best. Right? Mm-hmm. If you're going to prioritize everyone else, that's totally fine. But your kids, your spouse, your work, everything else that you're doing, really don't they deserve you to be the very best that you can be? And for you to be the very best that you can be, you need to be nourishing in the right way, right? And you need to have that environment, you know, and at bare minimum, the pantry cleaned out so that when you are hungry, you can reach into that cabinet, that pantry, that freezer, that refrigerator, and pull anything out blindly. Reach in, pull it out blindly and say, oh, this is healthy, I can eat it, right?
And that's also within, like, we've talked before about like our quarterly detoxes. So we understand, like, you know, things, you know, slip back in, or you just, you have the moment where you set the intention to just be a little bit more strict. And that's also a great time just to, again, because even like Dr. Bradley has talked about too, with his kids, you know, things come into the house. And so having, you know, a time where you can, take that time and clean out the cupboards and donate those foods, or, you know, do what you will with them. But yeah, building the environment again for your success so that you can be your best and feel your best. And yeah, again, easier said than done, but you're worth it and you deserve to feel good, and whatever that's going to take. I know that your family wants you to feel good too. They might be sad to not get, you know, fried chicken every single week, but you know, we can adjust and we'll be all right. That's just one thing. Like, that's what my dad is like, we'd never have these fried foods. I'm like, for good reason. Like,
hey, and those air fryers, I'm telling you what, I am telling you what a game changer, right? I mean, I know we don't have one. We were at a friend's house the other night and she made it was basically air fried chicken, right? But it didn't, it was, you know, gluten-free and this and that and the whole, you know, the whole thing. And I was so impressed with it.
I need one. They've been too popular. I know. And this one, I feel like with the air fryer too, I mean, you can, oh my gosh, there's just so much. And I've heard, especially compared to like the Instapot, like the one con with the Instapot is it can be kind of confusing. And also like, it is very quick after it's preheated, but it takes like 15, 20 minutes to preheat. Right. Whereas with the air fryer, it's pretty much ready in a few minutes and then it cooks your food and you're, you know, good to go. But I
hear you. And speaking of Marie Kondo, I think that, you know, I personally am fairly good at like, let's, you know, divest of X, Y, or Z. I'm okay with letting things go, except for books. I love books. Mm-hmm. I'm okay with, you know, purging and simplifying and all that. But man, when it comes to kitchen gadgets are my downfall. But you know, it's because I want food prep to be super simple, you know, and I think that I've invested, I wouldn't say a small fortune. I mean, it's not really that big of a deal. It's like these are luxuries to me because I didn't have them growing up. Right. Mm-hmm. I come from a post-depression era household. I swear I do. You know, I'm a lot older than I look. No, I'm kidding. But you know, I wasn't raised with kitchen gadgets, you know, I mean, we had like a hand mixer and we had, you know, all that stuff, but man, what is that called? An immersion blender.
Immersion blender.
That mm-hmm. immersion blender, the Blessing. Instant pot, the, what's it's, we have a Cuisinart, but you know, people call it the George Foreman grill, you know, like that electric grill. I mean, there's just so many, and I have so many iron cooking pans now.
I think it's totally worth an investment. I mean, if you know, it's something that, I mean, the cool thing with kitchen tools is again, there's such a variety of them, but they're like, you can invest just a little bit more to know that product's going to last you for years and years and years. And if it's going to help you be more consistent and more motivated to, you know, eat what you know is going to nourish your body, then I think that's worth the investment.
I think so too. And I'll tell you what, one of the bigger investments that it wasn't even a lot. It wasn't like it was a lot of money, but one of the best investments that I made was getting a good knife set. And I know I mean, and I don't mean one of those like $1,000 knife sets. I mean, listen, if you want to get that, by all means, please let me know how it goes. Right. But I mean, I have a couple of really nice, you know, kitchen knives and and a couple of good, you know, cutting blades, and I'm thrilled with them because I was buying like ceramic blades because they were sharp when you first buy them, but then, you know, they break and they, you know, and other blades don't stay as sharp. So silly investment, but I don't Marie Kondo my kitchen very well. But I will say that we use everything that's in there. So maybe she would say it's okay.
Yeah. Hey, I think if you're using it, and again, if it's going to help you be more successful, then, you know, investment well worth it. And I think kind of along with that, just thinking about different environments and the different, you know, lifestyle habits that we have. So diet's obviously a really, really big one, but especially with movement, I think it's interesting. Like as I was preparing for this call, it's interesting to me how much the environment can affect our willingness to want to move, whether that's, you know, if I have a designated space in my basement, or if there's, you know, a trail by my house, or if there's a gym nearby. You know, those are kind of things that we need to consider within our environment. And those are really important for our consistency, I think, with movement. And I think, you know, even just thinking about, like, you know, if my designated space for movement is my basement and it's just a mess all the time, well, I'm not really probably going to want to clean that up before I move. So I guess movement's just like, maybe not happening today. But it's, yeah, I think, again, just having, you know, an organized space or even like a designated space doesn't mean your whole house has to be completely pristine all the time. And this goes really well along with like stress management too. Like, do you have a quiet space, a clean, quiet space in your home that allows you to relax? And thinking back to one of the first points I mentioned about how environment can affect our mood, you know, if we're irritated and pissed off that our house is always dirty, that's not generally going to make us more motivated to, you know, do our hits that we need to do, or, you know, yeah, it's just interesting. And yeah. I'm curious on your thoughts on that, Dr. B, whether it's movement or stress management. Like,
I think
have you noticed? Yeah.
Totally.
The effect on the environment.
Absolutely. Yeah, absolutely. You know, we are blessed that we have it's not pretty by any means. I want to be really clear about this. But down in our basement, we have a dedicated space to, you know, exercise equipment and working out. We actually don't, we like to do yoga, and we try to do yoga daily, and we don't quite get it in every day. But we actually don't go down to the basement to do that yoga because, again, it's not like a pretty space. It's more of like an industrial. I think I'm being nice here. But you know, it's more of an industrial space. But we have our treadmill down there, and the treadmill at least looks out over, you know, our backyard. And so there's a little bit of nature there. You know, we specifically bought a house that is right near a trail, so that we have, you know, a biking, hiking trail, like right near us.
Yeah.
And that's a big deal for us. I mean, it was important to us, you know, as far as getting out in nature and extroverting a little bit and having that space available. You know, it's like an extension of our backyard, you know, which is nice. So I think having those dedicated spaces are really important. Mm-hmm. You know, I think another thing that comes to mind though, and so, you know, coming to the meditation space, you said have a quiet, what did you say? Quiet, dedicated space.
Yeah, even like it doesn't necessarily have to be clean, but if it's causing you stress being in that environment, then it's not conducive to, you know, reducing your stress. It's just adding to it.
And I was going to say in that same note, I was going to say, you know, and not only quiet, you know, dedicated space, but also someplace that you feel safe.
Yeah.
And I think that a lot of times, I know that seems like a silly thing to say, but, you know, unfortunately, there are situations where it's hard to find that safe space, right? Mm-hmm. So sometimes, and God knows my heart goes out to anybody in this situation, but if you can't find a safe space in your home to have a few minutes to breathe, then, you know, God knows, please private message me, and I'll do everything I can to help you, you know, in any way possible. But we got to have that safe, quiet, dedicated space. And it's got to be that, you know, even if it's, you know, mommy's in the bedroom, and if there is a tie on the doorknob, it means do not knock. It means do not interrupt me. I am taking 5, 10, 15, 20, 30 minutes of mommy time, and that's what I'm doing. And the household needs to respect that, you know, and it's the least, believe me, having worked with, you know, thousands of women over the last 22 years, it's the least that we all, this guy right here and all of us can do. For everything that those mommies are doing, right? For the house. I mean, if mom needs 20, 30 minutes, then mom needs 20, 30 minutes. You know, and that's just the way that it is. So yep. getting your household on board with you there as well is very important. Go ahead.
Right. I was just saying, again, along with that, and I mean, by them allowing you that time to be by yourself is only going to help you be better when you do reconnect with them, because you'll be more level-headed, you'll feel more relaxed and connected with yourself. And I know it's easier said than done to get me time, but again, like, you deserve that. And finding a way to prioritize that is not only going to help you, but it's going to help, you know, your family. It's going to help your, you know, your reaction to certain situations, or your, you know, even just kind of your baseline level of stress, just by being able to have a few minutes or 10, 15, even if you just start with, you know, 2 minutes, 5 minutes, that's still better. Or even a minute.
Yeah.
Start with 60 seconds.
Yeah.
And just take a moment to yourself, breathe, allow yourself to just acknowledge non-judgmentally just acknowledge how you're feeling and be observant of that. And even just being able to acknowledge and speak on our emotions or our feelings, I feel like that's something we get into autopilot a lot, and we don't always acknowledge how we're feeling when we're feeling it. Being able to take that break, again, even if it's for a minute, just to acknowledge, like, okay, I'm anxious right now. And, you know, even if you don't do anything about it, even just being able to say that to yourself is still, you know, better than just completely ignoring that feeling.
I totally hear you on that. And I think that 1 minute is very important. I just to kind of give a little couple tricks here and a little story. I have had a book that I've written in my head many times called The 1 Minute Yogi. I think Natalie's heard me talk about it before, you know, where, you know, I was thinking about, man, it's awfully hard to set aside an hour a day or 30 minutes a day, or sometimes 15 minutes, or sometimes even 5 minutes. And I started thinking about things that you could do in 1 minute to just help diffuse stress, right? You know, and breathing is one of those things. And then, so I decided that instead of a book, it's probably more of a pamphlet. And instead of a pamphlet, it's probably more of just a sentence or two, like, just remember to breathe, right? But this is something that I do that is a little goofy, but it's helped me out tremendously. And it's habit stacking. I don't think we're going to talk about that too much today, but this is what I do. When I'm in the car, every time I'm in the car, whenever I'm driving somewhere, when I get to my destination, I turn off the car and I breathe for 1 minute. Mm-hmm. That's it. You know, so I'm not in the car a million times a day. You know, I know some people are, but, you know, I'm not in the car a million times a day. You know, sometimes my destination is somewhere I'm going and coming home, right? So I would have two destinations there, my one destination spot and then my trip home, right? I think today I'll have a trip to my chiropractor, which I'm excited about. Then I'll have a trip to the grocer, and then I'll have a trip home, right? But I will have a minimum of 3 minutes of pausing and breathing and recentering. And it literally takes no time, right? I mean, it's 1 minute. And I remember to do it because I've stacked it with this mundane thing just of transportation from getting from point A to point B to point C. You know, and I know it works pretty well. And then God knows if you have, you know, a lot of destinations, you know, obviously the more that you take that 1 minute, it starts to add up together, right? You don't have to do 20 minutes of centered breath all at once. They all accumulate over the day and over time. So, you know, do I have some dedicated time and space to do some breathing, some breath work every single day? I do. Do I also do it when I get in the car and get out of, you know, when I get out of the, before I get out of the car, I do that too. Right. And it's just a good reminder to be present. The other thing I just wanted to say, speaking of space, is as we're talking about creating a good environment, sometimes space is time, right? And sometimes it's, there's a couple of things here, but sometimes we just need to make sure that we have that. If we can't find 1 minute to breathe in a day, again, something's really not right. Something's really extremely not right. And it shouldn't be the 1 minute before your eyes finally, you know, close for the night, right? I mean, that's another good time to do some breath work and gratitudes and prayers and all that kind of stuff too. But at the same time, there should be times throughout the day that everyone has the ability to do that. And again, if we don't have that, then there's probably bigger issues going on. And I would welcome anybody that needs help with that just to reach out. And I'm here to help in any way that I can.
Yeah. And Dan and I, just on Mondays, actually Motivational Monday, we were talking about stress management when you feel like you have no time. And there were two or three clients that Dan has worked with that, you know, they do have a very demanding work and family schedule, and it's just hard for them to find that time. But they, you know, committed to 60 seconds, you know, every hour, every other hour, especially like once an hour while you're at work, even if you're not able to take a 5 minute break or a 10 minute break, just take 60 seconds, just 60 seconds. And like you said, just breathe. And maybe there's some, you know, kind of thought provoking questions that you have, or even just asking yourself, how am I feeling right now? Like, do I notice any tension anywhere? Is there anything that is like immediately stressing me out? And again, just be honest with yourself and be there with yourself for that minute. And then again, even if you don't have time to do anything about it, you still took that minute to acknowledge that feeling. And then, you know, you can spend more time analyzing it when you have time. But
and I was going to say, take that time to acknowledge, since we're just keep acknowledging and patting ourselves on the back, but to give yourself credit for taking that minute. You know,
yeah.
I just took a minute to myself, you know, and that's a big deal for a lot of people. I mm-hmm. was giving a lecture to 300 food scientists at Genencor a number of years ago. And I just asked them how many of them took at least 1 minute a day just to breathe and recenter. And there were two people raised their hands out of 300. And I realized, you know, these are professionals, you know, these are people that would have the time, the space, you know, to be able to do this. And they weren't doing it. And again, it's just because it's not part of our culture. You know, we're not really taught that. And I think it's something that's really lacking. And I think it's an important piece of it.
I agree. Yeah. And kind of like I said earlier, we're all very used to just like go, 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 go. And, you know, a lot of times that autopilot kind of kicks in, but in the midst of that autopilot and, you know, yeah, sometimes we get into the flow, which is, you know, flow is better than autopilot. But yeah, once, you know, even if you are in that autopilot, being able to just pause that and be, what's the opposite of autopilot? You're
conscious.
Driving the bus now.
Sure.
Yeah, thank you. Conscious, there you go. Or even just mindful, like that goes along with it too. Just a minute of mindfulness. And the cool thing too is, like Dr. B said, it's cumulative. So, you know, you don't have to sit there for a full 30 minutes. You can do, you know, one or a few minutes throughout the day, and it's still going to add up.
Yep.
And again, with stress management specifically, the more consistent and the more you practice it, the more beneficial it's going to be, especially when you practice it when you're not super duper stressed. You're just, it's really it's sort of like you're in a way like biohacking your brain. You're in those less stressful times and you're working on and acknowledging that state of calm, so it'll be easier when you are super stressed to bring yourself back into that state of calm. Again, super, it's a lot easier said than done, but start with a minute, start with 2 minutes, and just see how it feels and build it from there.
You know, and I would say that if during those minutes and during that calm time and during that space, if there is something that just keeps popping in your head
mm-hmm.
that, you know, you just can't set down, that should be the thing that we're working on. You know, that should be the one thing, like, what can we do to help that one thing, you know, mm-hmm. and it might not even be a simple solution. It might be a multi-step solution, and it might take time and effort, right? But, you know, we all know baby steps go a long way. The 1% rule of just trying to make, you know, a 1%, you know, improvement every day accumulates over time very quickly.
It does.
You know, so it sure does.
And this
sometimes just thinking, that space to think, and that freedom to think about that mm-hmm. process, even if, you know, I'll tell you what, I'll finish that sentence, but sometimes just that space to think is as important as anything else, right? Giving yourself that minute, just like you said, to acknowledge those feelings and acknowledge what's coming up, and then give yourself a pat on the back for taking the time to do that.
Yeah.
You'll get some of your best answers in the quietest space, right? Like I can almost promise you that your brain knows what the solution is. It's just a matter of bringing it to the forefront, right? On the flip side, I did want to say, when I'm doing my breath work, I ain't thinking about nothing. You know, I am thinking, I'm literally focusing on my breath going in, holding it and my breath going out and holding it, right? You know?
That was, or sorry, I kind of cut you off.
No, that's it.
That was my favorite part about yoga is I took classes when I was in college and it was a 50-minute class. And at the very beginning, every single time she was like, I don't want you to worry about the homework that you have left to do or the class that you have this afternoon. You are here and present for this class and you don't like, it's not going to serve you to stress about anything in this 50 minutes. Like you're here, you can stress about it when this 50 minutes is over, but just being present and there and yeah, you don't, and you know, our it's natural for our minds to wander, but for us to be mindful of that and catch it and be like, oh cool, my mind's trying to go to this place, but I'm just going to come back to my breathing, or I'm just going to come back to the sensations that I feel within my body, or, you know, whatever that is. And as you were talking, Dr. Bradley, it made me think, so kind of like you said, you know, if there's one thing that keeps popping up, you know, it's worth looking into. And it made me think of this document, and I'm actually going to pull it up or share my screen real quick. So this is something called the wellness or the Wheel of Life, also known as the Wellness Map 360. This was shared in my coaching course that I'm going through. And I think this is a great way, you know, at Epic, we spend a lot of time looking in, you know, the health and well-being side of things. But, you know, these are all really important still to consider. And basically with this document, you mark, you know, in each of these slices, you mark your level of satisfaction, one being least satisfied, 10 being more satisfied or fulfilled, if you will. And I think this is a great, just like simple way to just lay out, you know, what, yeah, how satisfied or unsatisfied are you in these areas? And if there's one area that's, you know, causing you a lot of stress, then, you know, again, could be worth it to look into that piece. And with some of these other ones, you know, I know with, you know, health and well-being, making different, you know, dietary hydration challenges or making some of those changes can be easier than, you know, making a career change or a significant other change. But, you know, if it's causing a great amount of stress to you, it is definitely worth looking into. And yes, Justice, I will share this. This will be included in our guide for today, which is actually a surprise to me. I didn't think about it when I was planning this call, but it's too good not to share and very relevant. And again, you know, it's very much worth it. If there is a piece of this puzzle that is causing you stress or is, you know, just if your unsatisfaction in that area is leading to, you know, you not feeling good about what's going on, then let's think about it. Let's see what we can do to increase your satisfaction or fulfillment in that area. And I like this question too. How smooth or bumpy is your life? I don't really like that question, but basically also I forgot to finish, you know, the instructions of this. You put a dot into each one of these and then you just connect the dots. And again, you get to see how smooth or bumpy is your circle. And you can also ask yourself again, what are areas in your life that need attention? And this is a good one too. What are areas you're willing to address now, sooner, later? You don't have to change, you know, you don't have to tackle all of the pieces right at once, but being able to prioritize like, okay, making a change here is, you know, going to build my confidence. It's going to build my motivation. And I'm not quite ready to work on these other pieces, but they're on my mind. And I know that I can get there and maybe you can start doing some planning, but you know, just think about it. It's going to be different for everyone, but worth considering.
Natalie, I love that chart. That's really, it's a cool chart.
I like it. I like this part too, because as adults, we often forget to have fun. Like what do you guys do for fun? I want to know that. That's a question I'm asking the group. What do you guys do for fun and recreation? I know for me, I like to paint. I like to do puzzles or just like hang out at a park. This weekend, I hung out in a hammock with one of my best friends and her dog. And we just sat in the sunshine and it was just so fun. And I just, yeah, I don't know. I'm really curious. And again, I feel like we just kind of get out of that. We're busy with work and life and family and responsibilities, but we deserve to have some fun.
We do, deserve to have some fun,
Dr. B. Oh, Melissa said roller skate. I have my skates. I have roller blades, technically. It took me a long time to figure out the difference there. I agree. Now that it's warmer, I'm getting back out on those. I love
That's
it.
That's awesome. I love rollerblading. Absolutely. I don't do it enough. Rachel doesn't have rollerblades. And so, you know, we're missing out there. I know we got to get her some.
Does she have a bike or something? You can always.
We have a bike. Yeah, no, she has a bike and she's not really like a biker either. She's a runner. And she would tell you what she does for fun is run. You know, she loves to run. Like it's like, I know me
to each their own.
Me too. Like ditto.
I'm so impressed by people that run a lot. I just,
yeah. I mean, I like movement. I mean, I like high intensity and training. Yeah. All that stuff, but I am not a runner by any means. And plus, not to mention that, I mean, for those of you that know Rachel, you know this, but for those of you that don't, she is tall and very svelte, like an elf, like a Tolkien elf. And I'm almost her height. She's got a half an inch on me, but you know, I am very rectangular and kind of like boxy, like a hobbit. So when we're out running together, it is like this like gazelle like creature, like, you know, doing this, and I'm just like, you know, doing one of the, you know, like it's just funny to watch. Oh, you know, for sure. No, I like hiking. Yeah, you know, I like adventure. So mm-hmm. anything that's exploring, right. anything like I like doing, I like going to new places, I like exploring yeah. new areas. You know, but hiking is a massive thing for me mm-hmm. because you can do it pretty much anywhere that you are, you know, you yeah. can find some place to go on a hike. But, I also like doing some things that are not necessarily activity driven. Like Natalie knows this. I play a little guitar, not super.
I still have one of your guitars.
I know you do. I was thinking about that the other day. You have the red electric one, right?
Yep.
The red axe, but, mm-hmm. But yeah, you know, I like to play guitar. I'm not that great at it, but it's kind mm-hmm. of my zen moment because right. I'm good enough that I can do it. You know, I've been playing mm-hmm. since I was 6 years old. You'd think I'd be a lot better than I am. But you know, I can do it and I can figure out songs and I can do that, mm-hmm. but I have to concentrate on it. So when I'm concentrating on it, I'm not thinking about the past. I'm not worried about the future. Mm-hmm. I am in that zen moment, mm-hmm. like that present moment right there. I yeah. love that. So finding activities that are zen for you, I think are magical, you know.
That's
and
interesting. Or go finish your
point. I was just gonna say, and guitar is my zen for sure.
Yeah, I feel like the word zen, so like finding your zen is also like finding activities that help you get into flow. So if you're yeah. not familiar with flow, it's kind of like what Dr. Bradley mentioned, like you're not thinking about anything else. You're fully invested and honestly energized by being fully invested in this activity. And it's like kind of just another way of being mindful too, but flow is like, you can be in a state of flow. So like thinking about professional tennis players, like when they're in the game, they're not thinking about all of these things to do. They've done it enough where it's just like second nature. They're just in it, fully involved, fully invested. And, you know, definitely not stressing about what they're going to have for dinner later
right.
or whatever else. But yeah. And Melissa too also mentioned she used to play roller derby, which sounds so fun. I feel like I would just get bruised up, but I feel like I feel like I would be all right. I don't know. I'm not really aggressive enough to be good at roller derby.
Little,
not that it's aggressive, but.
Little known fact, but our administrative assistant Caleb was actually going into professional roller derby. I know.
What?
Yep. He's actually very skilled on the skates. He has coached teams. He has coached kids. The reason
Please
that he
teach me.
Well, he could coach you. The reason he had to not do it professionally is that he had an ACL. And specifically because of roller derby. He was injured and it took him out of the professional league. But yeah, that was his entire life plan. Now he works with us.
Light change of plans there. Right. Just a little bit. Oh my goodness. I didn't know that. I'm going to have to talk to him about that.
He's got some cool stories. And I used to go, Rach and I used to go and watch him compete. You know, he's like I said, he's got mad skills other than, I mean, his knee, unfortunately, but right. totally mad skills. Yeah.
Oh, that's so cool. Oh my gosh. Yeah. And I had multiple friends in high school that had a ACL injury, so I'm very familiar with the repercussions that can come along with that.
It's why I don't downhill ski right there, because back when I was doing physical medicine and pain management eons ago, like 25 years ago, right, and working with sports medicine, I saw way too many post ACL injuries from downhill skiing. And I have sworn it off completely.
Yeah, it happens. To each their own. So whatever you like to do for fun, find some more things and involve the kids. We can learn so much by just children's like natural curiosity and appreciation for, you know, bugs and trees and nature. And they just are so invested in the fun. And in that way, we could learn a lot from kids. And again, I mean, it's just going to be, we're just kind of, spitballing different things that are, words are hard. We're covering a lot of bases here, but also we're kind of coming in on the end of it. This one's a bit longer than our other ones have been. We've kind of stuck around 30 minutes, but I think it's worth it to kind of expand this conversation because it's been fun. And
it's because this Yahoo's on here forever. And I'll just, you and I can talk forever. So
I know, but just kind of getting back into like the environment piece and even along with movement too, you can also consider like, is your neighborhood, conducive for, movement? Do you have, like Dr. B has, like a trail, or do you have neighbors that you enjoy or not enjoy? You know, your neighborhood or that kind of social environment can really affect stress and those other pieces too. So again, there's a lot to consider, and even just kind of reviewing a little bit regarding, all that there is within the environment. Our physical environment can affect our sleep. It can affect our stress levels. It can affect our willingness and motivation to move or eat right or hydrate right. I knew there was one more pillar left I needed to mention. But, and also along with that too, there's kind of similar to, all Epic Five. You don't need to change everything at once. Pick one thing that you think would be helpful for you. And even our question of the day today, let me look it up. So, if there was one thing that was better organized to suit your ideal environment, what would it be? Which is, it's a very broad question, but that gives you the control, is it within your sleep environment? Do you wanna, adjust something there? Is it within the space that you do your movement, or do you want to create, a safe, quiet space for your stress management or, yoga activity? There's so much that could be, adjusted, and you've got the power to decide, what in your life, if there was something that could be more organized to help you be more successful, what might that be? And so I'm curious here, I didn't close that loop very well, but as we kind of wrap up, just curious, is there, I know we have a couple people on our Zoom call. Do you guys have anything that you want to share, or, Dr. B, any final kind of words of advice or encouragement as we wrap up?
Absolutely. I just did some coaching or a group call, in our private client group. And I just wanted to say that one of the strengths that I think that we forget is announcing to the world what our intentions are, right? And I think that, as we're going through and saying, I'm going to declutter this way, I'm going to create this environment, I need this to be my best self. And I mean, there's probably lots of things that all of us need, but just kind of prioritizing you is the start. And I would say, have the conversation with the people around you to say, hey, this is for my environment, this is what I, whether that just be something like the pantry, like we were talking about, or if it's, I can't stand, I don't know why this is sitting here, but I'll just say, this tape measure, that's been sitting here for, 2 days now, why is that not put away? I can't stand that anymore. And I can't stand it when we leave things like that out, I'm teasing that's me leaving it out, by the way. And it's in my workspace, but at any rate, whatever it is, have that conversation with your main support people, with your family, And really, I think that if you start to open up that dialogue, you're going to find out that there's strength in numbers. There's good conversations to be had. They leave it open for them also. Like, what do they need in their environment? Yeah. What changes would they like to see in an ideal world? Mm-hmm. You know, and I think it will go a long way when you start to get that momentum with a family, with a household, right. All behind this. It can be different little pieces of that vision, but mm-hmm. with that same vision, man, it is so empowering. And as we know, EPIC, you know, the E in EPIC stands for empowerment.
I was just going to say empowering the person to impact the community, even right. if the community is your little family,
right.
it's still making an impact. And I agree, there's definitely power in numbers. And I mean, yeah, it's definitely easier to make these changes when you do have a solid support system. And I mean, that social, you know, part of the environment, the people that are in your house, your neighbors, your family, they are an integral part of your journey and your progress. So like Dr. Bradley said, being clear with them on what your expectations are, what, you know, what is ideal for you and how could they help, but also, like you said, opening that up for them too, not only just asking them to do all of these things and make these adjustments for your health and well-being, but check in with them too. You know, what else could I be doing to help support you as you, you know, continue to help support me. So, and of course you've got this EPIC 5 plan community. Again, I know that, you know, getting the family members on board is easier said than done. It's definitely possible, but easier said than done. But if there is some, you know, resistance, you've got a community of almost 2,800 people in this, which it blows my mind that we have almost 3,000 members in here already, but we've built this community for this reason. So, you know, reach out, ask for help, let people know how you're doing, what's going on. And I guarantee you are not alone. And there are potentially hundreds, if not, you know, more people that have either been in your shoes or are, you know, in similar shoes as you currently.
Totally.
So,
yep.
Yeah.
Awesome.
But yeah, on that note, thank you again, everyone, for joining today.
Thanks, Natalie.
Of course. I'll be posting the question of the day right after we end this call. So keep an eye out for that. And again, just if you answer that question, comment under that post. I'll be sending out all of the guides tomorrow. I'll start on some of them, or I have the guides ready, but I'm going to share them all together because a lot of people are commenting on multiple of the days. So keep an eye out for those. Most will be sent out by tomorrow. May have to catch up a few in the beginning of the week, but no worries. I'll get them all over to you. But have an awesome day. And thanks again for joining Dr. B and Justice. And Melissa just hopped out. But have an awesome day. And we'll catch you guys here.
Thanks, guys.
At 1 o'clock with Dan tomorrow.
See you guys.
All right. Bye.